Good morning, and welcome to Easter worship with the Community Church of Sebastopol, an open and affirming congregation in the United Church of Christ. As we begin our worship in this sacred place, we respectfully acknowledge that our church's sanctuary is located on the traditional and unceded land of the Southern Pomo and Coast Miwok peoples who have been stewarding this land for generations. Today is Easter Sunday, also known as the Day of Resurrection. This is the beginning of the 50-day season of Easter, which stretches until Pentecost Day this year. That will be on May 19th. Our liturgists are Jessa Drury and Ko Dunka. Jessa is an educator and Ko is a massage therapist. Thank you, Ko and Jessa, for helping lead our worship this morning. We are also grateful to our handbell ensemble, directed by Karna Roa, and our chancel choir, directed by Andy Del Monte, for providing worship music this morning. And thank you to our keyboardist, Althea, and to Judy Kinsey, who along with Karna will be playing organ for our worship. Hello to those of you who are joining us online. Please leave a message in the chat or simply like the video so that we can know you were a part of our worship this morning. To access the worship bulletin, the announcements, or to make an offering, you can go to our website, uccseb.org. At Community Church, we love seeing new faces and learning new names. If you're worshiping with us for the first or second time, would you just simply wave so that we can see who you are and have a chance to say hello? A good number of you, welcome. Really wonderful to have you with us. Hello, welcome. There are some seats up here. There are two, like, empty pews right up here. Usually I joke that there's like a pulpit buffer, but the pulpit buffer is kind of filled in nicely. But we do have a piano buffer that can be filled in over here. Let's see, where was I? Following the service, everyone is invited to join together right out here in our bell tower courtyard for kinship time. For those of you who are here in the sanctuary, please sign and pass along the black attendance pad. It's located on the inner aisle of the pew, and just pass it toward the outside and take note of the names of those who are seated near you. You could even call your neighbor by name when we pass the peace a little bit later. If you are visiting, we'd love some contact information so that we can be in touch with you. The announcement insert in your bulletin outlines upcoming events in the life of the church. I encourage you to look that over. I'll just highlight a few items. On the back panel of that insert are all of the dedications for the Easter lilies that are here on our chancel. They're so lovely. And a special thank you to Kathy Mathis for the chancel decor for our Easter worship. Yes. Also, if you have some time following the service and could be part of a ministry where we bring some of these lilies and other flowers to some of our homebound members, you can meet Kathy Bell here on the chancel just following the service. You can take one flower, you can take multiple flowers. You might really make someone's day if you could do that. Also, a few other announcements. You may have noticed that Legally Blonde is showing at Annalie. The reason why I'm pointing this out is because the choreographer, Brooke Bell, is a member of this church. And also Judy Hawkinson's grandchild is in the show. And next week, our own Alina Kingwill Peterson has a starring role in this production. So it's going to be, it's today at 2? Is it today at 2? No. Not today at 2. Don't come today at 2. It's next weekend at 7. And at 2 on Sunday, yes. Also, I want to let you know that our monthly newsletter, our Salt and Light newsletter, just came out. This is for the month of April. We may email this out to everybody, but if you'd like a paper copy, there are some available in the narthex on our rainbow lectern. Finally, I would like to let you know that a baby has been born into our congregation. Last Sunday, on Palm Sunday, during Faith Formation Hour, I received a message from Quent Cole. Tony Cole gave birth to Forrest Anthony Cole last Sunday morning, and so we are overjoyed for them and for all of us. At this time, I invite our handbell ensemble to ring us into a spirit of Easter, rejoicing as we worship our living and loving God.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, beginning with the first verse. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome brought spices so they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror had and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Here ends the reading of the gospel. Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah!
As able, please stand for the call to worship. Yours.
Church, please respond to me when I say Christ is risen. Please respond with risen indeed. Let's give it a try, church. Christ is risen.
Risen indeed.
When I say hallelujah, please respond by saying hallelujah indeed. Let's do it, church. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed.
Let's put it all together. Christ is risen.
Risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed.
Amen.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Christ has risen.
Risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed. And let us rejoice and be glad in it.
And let's shout out the good word. Christ has risen.
Risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed.
Christ is risen.
Risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed.
Christ is risen.
Risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Worship, please respond to me in the opening prayer. Holy One, you come to us with power beyond all knowing. You lift all things out of the dust. You breathe life into every cell. You call us into communion with you, and you claim victory over death. Blessed be your holy name, now and forever. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. I invite you to share a sign of Christ's peace with your neighbor. Good morning, church. Good morning, friends. Children, I'd like to invite you forward for a special message that's just for you. Hello. Hi.
I could fly if I was
back. Ooh. Good morning. Good morning. Hello, my friends. So everything is different now. Come join us. Come join us. I wonder if we could make a little bit of space for some more friends. Can you back up just a little bit? We'll make some space. Hello. That's just right. So the church had been all dressed in purple, and today everything turns white. Yes. Wonderful. Well, last night I picked up a ball of dry, crispy leaves, and I wanted to show you a few of what they looked like. I peeled off a few, and I have them here in this, on this plate. Do you see? What do they look like to you?
Dead.
They're looking pretty dead. Yeah.
Sticks.
They look like sticks. What else do you see?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Kyle. Oh, yeah, it looks like dead sticks, or it could be like kind of a type of leaf or something like that. Yeah. Oh, like maybe a branch, maybe like off of a redwood tree or something? Oh, wow, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, really? Yeah. Well, I wanted to share with you the story of Easter, and I have here something for you to see. This is a tomb. So Jesus died, and his friends were very sad. And they placed his body into a tomb, and they rolled the stone in front of it, and it shut like a locked door. And then for a whole day, everything was quiet. You could almost hear the earth breathe. It was so quiet the next day. And then on Sunday morning, something happened. Three of Jesus' friends came to the tomb. There was Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome. And they came holding spices that they were going to place onto Jesus' body. And when they got to the tomb, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, and inside was someone wearing white robes. And that person said, "Jesus is not here. He has been raised. Look," and you can see all that's in there is a piece of linen cloth. Yeah, you can, we'll take it out and show our friends. See? All that was there was a piece of linen cloth. I'm going to put it back. And that's the story of Easter. And if you'd like to see this again after worship, I will show you again. Yeah, Lily.
What if the Easter
bunny? Oh, that's a very good question. You'll have to ask your mom about that one. So, then, it reminded me of new life. And I wanted to show you something because last night, I poured water right onto those dry twigs, and I wanted to show you what happened to them. And I have it here under this white silk. Oops, and also under this basket. And what do we see? Holy guacamole. Do you see that? Look what happened to those dry, dead sticks. What does it look like now?
They turned into a plant.
They turned into a plant. Do you know that this plant, this little ball of dried twigs, has been sitting in my office for 2 years? Just dry and dead? Yeah, and some water overnight, and look what happens. There is new life all around us. All the time, if only we have the eyes to see. And the story of Easter teaches us to look for new life. So will you pray with me? God, we thank you for signs of new life, even in places that seem crispy and dried up and hopeless. You bring new life even to those places. And we thank you for the person of Jesus who taught his disciples to pray, saying, "Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Well, thank you so much for sharing a story with me. And if you'd like to join nursery care, Kelly is in the back and she'll be with you. Or you can go and join your families for the rest of the worship service. So thank you very much and happy Easter.
Our next hymn is number 638 in your hymnal. In body or spirit, please stand and sing. In the bulb there is a flower. In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree. In cocoons a hidden promise, Butterflies will soon be free in the cold and snow of winter. There's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds a mystery. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. In our end is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, at the last a victory. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Please be seated. You sound good, church. The singing sounds good. And it makes a difference, doesn't it? To take some time to sing together, to lift up our voices, maybe even especially when we're not feeling it. Sometimes you can sing your way into feeling it. Over the course of the season of Lent, the 7 weeks leading up to today, we have been focusing on crosstalk. That is, through our hymns and our music and our scripture and our preaching and our prayers, we have been meditating on various meanings of the cross. Today, we make something of a shift. In a sense, today we are on the other side of the cross. Whereas we have been reading epistles, that is, the letters of Paul throughout the season of Lent, I'm going to share another section from one of Paul's epistles. This is from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians, the 15th chapter, the first 11 verses. This chapter focuses on the resurrection. Paul writes to the community there, "Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaim to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you, as of first importance, what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And God's grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe." Here ends the reading of the epistle. May the Holy Spirit add understanding to our hearing of this, God's holy word. Amen. As I mentioned, we've been focusing on the cross over the season of Lent in preparation for today. And you may notice that on the front of your bulletin, very prominently displayed, is a cross. The artist, the painter, Georgia O'Keeffe, called it the Black Cross. You might know that a few years ago I was on sabbatical, and part of my sabbatical was to visit a retreat center in northern New Mexico. In fact, it was a retreat center that was in the very spot where Georgia O'Keeffe derived her inspiration. In fact, they would give tours based on her paintings where you could walk to a certain place and hold up the painting and then look at the landscape, and there it all was, all right down to the cow skull right there in front of you. Georgia O'Keeffe was not a particularly religious or even spiritual person, which to me is surprising given the beauty and the expression of her painting. But she did report that while wandering those barren lands there, the deserted area in northern New Mexico, she would often come across crosses just in the middle of the wilderness. And she was often left to ponder, maybe was even perplexed at why there might have been a cross in this place here. You might know about the history of the Southwest, that there were Spanish colonialists who brought the Christian religion and brought crosses and so forth to that land. So indeed, that would have been part of the background of that. But it wasn't always clear why here in this place where there's not even a trail, does there happen to be a cross there? Is it marking a grave? Was it a place where one of the practitioners had walked out into the desolate wilderness and had received some kind of message or epiphany or a sense of deep and abiding presence there in the wilderness? Perhaps they felt like they were experiencing what Jesus himself had experienced during his 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness and wanted to leave a cross in commemoration. When you look at the front of your bulletin, what do you see? O'Keeffe said that when she looked at this particular cross, it was all made out of wood, even the pegs. The pegs were even wooden pegs, exactly fitted to fit so that the crossbar would fit on to the upright bar just perfectly. What do you see in that picture? You see different shades of color. When I was on my sojourn in New Mexico, I went with a geologist. I always want to call them geologians. That's my bias. Geologist, and saying, "Now stop right here. Now, do you see this? Do you see that? Do you see that green layer in the soil?" And we would all nod. And she would say to us, "Well, that is a 300 million year old layer of tropical sediment from when this piece of land was close to the equator." And do you see a little bit above that, there's a reddish clay-looking layer that goes through that? And we said, yes, that is from 250 million years ago when there was a large floodplain here and it deposited red sediment across the area. And the rest of our brains exploded. I can see some of those colors in the painting to suggest that this cross is planted in the midst of geologic history. But also, while on my sojourn, we went and visited some Tewa Pueblo ruins that were there with the kiva in the center and pottery shards along the trail as you walked. And I wondered whether or not O'Keeffe had imagined that there were the ancestors of the Anasazi and of the Pueblo people who were buried in that land. Maybe those are burial mounds of a sort. In other words, it's important that the cross is planted in the midst of history, not just an idea, but a place where our human history and divine presence come together. It's such a strange story that we gather around this morning. I don't mean the Easter Bunny one. That's a strange one, too. You might have heard that come up in the children's message. But this story of Easter, this story of a cross where a person representing the marginalized people of his land is finally arrested and put to death by the Roman authorities, to be shut up in prison and finally executed like this, is to silence the rabble-rouser and try to put all of those who would also want to create trouble for the empire, to put them in their place. And for an entire day, all of his followers wondered, is this the end? And then we're confronted by this story. This year we hear Mark's version, and all the versions are slightly different. There are all different numbers of people who come to the tomb, though one constant is that they are all women. The women disciples were the ones who were to abide the longest there at the cross, and who were the ones who were to arrive the earliest at the tomb. In Mark's account, three women, Mary Magdalene, Mary mother of James, and Salome, come, and do you remember what they're bringing with them? They're bringing spices. You see, they're expecting to find a dead body, and they're expecting to perform their duty. That is, their duty of washing and embalming the dead body so that it can lay in the tomb until the time comes when they can gather the bones and place them in an ossuary for its final resting place. So they've come to enact a final ritual of love with a very practical purpose. But when they arrive, they're talking about, who are we going to get to roll the massive stone away from this garden tomb? And when they get there, the stone has already been rolled away. And they're amazed at this. They're amazed when they stick their heads into the tomb and find that there is someone there. But it is not Jesus. It is a person they don't recognize, who looks at them and must see the look on their face. They must look terrified, seized with fear and confusion, which is why the messenger says to them, "Do not be alarmed. I know who you're looking for. You're looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is not here. As you can see, look, there is where he was laid, and there was the linen cloth. But now you must go and tell the rest of his disciples that he has gone on ahead of you back to Galilee, and there you will see him." And of course, they left with terror and amazement, and the text tells us they didn't say anything to anyone as they ran away. End of the gospel. Now you might say, "Preacher, I've been following along in my pew Bible, and there are some words after that." Well, let me tell you about that. The most ancient version of the scroll that Mark is written on, the bottom of it is very well worn, and some scholars think that the end of Mark was lost to time. But there are no other letters down there, no sign of the ending of Mark. There are a few other later endings. You'll find in your pew Bible the shorter version and the longer version, but scholars are pretty clear that both of these use language that Mark would not have used. And so early on in the church tradition, they also, just like we, were uncomfortable with the way that Mark ended. They wanted to add an ending that was a little more palatable. Not quite the Easter Bunny story, but maybe close. They fled with terror and amazement, and said nothing to anyone. Now, I've shared with this congregation some aphorisms that my mother likes to share with me. My favorite, which you've heard before, is, "You have two ears and one mouth, play the odds." I also remember her telling me once, Ben, you should drive as if everyone else on the road is completely insane. Now, this is coming to home a little bit because my own 15-year-old, who's back running the tech right now, just got her permit about a week ago. And so that aphorism has come back up into my head a little bit as she's been driving me around. And I have been tempted to say to her, Sophia, you should drive as if everyone else on the road is completely insane. But I'll have to take issue with that wisdom. If we were to drive or live as if everyone else was insane, I don't know about you, but I would never, ever drive. The only time I would ever drive is if I could be assured that no one else would be on the road. And so we have got to trust some other people. We have got to drive as if just about everyone can be trusted to stay in their lane. Now we know it's not everyone, but we need to act as if we're going to be able to get where we're going, at least most of the time. Now there is a huge thing missing from Mark's gospel, yes? What's missing from Mark's gospel is any appearance of the risen Christ to anyone. In the other gospels, we have appearances. He appears to the disciples. He appears to Mary Magdalene. He appears to a whole bunch of people in this place. He suddenly is in a room where the doors have been locked. He appears to a couple who are walking along the road to Emmaus. We hear about all of these different appearances, but not in Mark. And in the text that we heard from Paul's epistle, we hear another account of appearances. You know, those words that I read to you from 1 Corinthians, those are probably the earliest written down accounts of the resurrection. Because Paul wrote down his letters before any of the gospel writers wrote down their stories. And so Paul says, he has this formula. He was killed, buried, risen, and then appeared. And he goes through this kind of list of his appearances, and he says, first he appeared to Cephas, and then to the 12, and then to 500, and then finally to me. But it doesn't jive with the gospel accounts. And I think what we should take from this is that Jesus appeared in different ways to different people. It was experienced by different communities in different kind of ways. I don't know about you, but I miss in Paul's account that Jesus first appeared to the women. I feel like they should be given the credit for hanging around at the cross and risking their lives as long as they did, and for showing up early on that first day, and for then carrying on the ministry. You know, you could say that the very first Easter sermon ever preached was by Mary Magdalene. Paul doesn't know anything about that, and we'll just let that be okay for Paul. But I want to concentrate on one thing that he says. He says, but lastly, to one untimely born, he appeared to me. Now, this is really interesting because the strongest tradition of the appearances says that he appeared for 50 days. That's the 50 days of Easter that we recognize. And that 40 days up until the day of the ascension. And on the ascension, Jesus was raised out of their sight, no longer to appear in bodily form, but then on Pentecost Sunday to send the Spirit. But in Paul's tradition, he's saying that after all of that, Jesus appeared to him too. So Paul is almost messing with our assumptions about appearances. That this Jesus made an appearance to him too as one untimely born, as if he were to say, I wish I had been born a little bit earlier, or had showed up earlier or closer to the moment of resurrection, so I could have been a part of all that. But even though I wasn't, I still caught a glimpse. I still heard a voice. I still knew that the one who had been crucified, the one who had been put to death by the powers that be, was raised again. was alive again. I can't exactly explain it, but I know it to be true. And so Paul then opens the door for us too to know that it is true that in some way or another, Jesus continues to appear here in this life. We have to live and trust and believe as if that is possible. I don't know about you, but I think we are living in a culture which is only expecting death. We are only expecting the same old thing. Even if our person gets elected, we are still expecting that the same kind of thing is going to play out over and over again. We have strived time and time again to make a difference, to make a change, and we can plot some of those changes on a chart, but it seems like we're always taking one step forward and two step back. We have become a people who are not expecting newness and resurrection. We come with our spices and we refuse or are unable to be astounded by the fact that the stone is no longer sitting in front of the tomb. That there is a message to be heard if we would just lean into the uncertainty, poke our heads around the corner, and open up our ears to hear. I know who you are looking for. Do not be alarmed. It is Jesus of Nazareth, yes, the one who was crucified, but he is not here. He is already gone out, already ahead of you. And if you keep looking back over your shoulder, you're never, ever going to see him. So you got to keep looking forward and you got to start moving forward. And right at this point, I want to say, I think maybe I got it wrong. I think maybe the Gospel of Mark does have an appearance story of a sort. You see, let us just trust that this is where Mark ends the Gospel. These three women are seized with terror and amazement, and they run off. But we know where they went, don't we? We know they went to Galilee. We know they told the disciples. And there is something that this way of telling the story, Mark's way of telling the story, leads us back to the beginning of the gospel, which began in Galilee. Let me say it again, because I think you missed it. The women hear that Jesus has gone on ahead to Galilee. It says they are seized with terror and amazement, and they run away. But we know that they went to Galilee. We know that they went and found the disciples. We know that they went and told them the good news. And what this telling of the story does is it leads us back to the beginning of Mark's gospel. So we are led to read the gospel again, and we are to read it in such a way as to say, ah, that is what this means. This one was sent into the world to be the very presence of God's loving grace here and now with us in Sebastopol. This, here, today, is where he appears. And in catching that glimpse, we catch a glimpse of the great possibility of God's newness. That death does not have the final word, but, and now I'll reappropriate the term as if in a late 80s, early 90s kind of fashion. Death? As if. Death, you don't get to have the last word. The last word is the healing ministry of Jesus in the midst of the people and God's people commissioned again, even in our terror and amazement, to go and to proclaim this most good news. Amen. Thank you.
You know, when Ben sent over the order of worship to Jessa and I to look through for this today, he asked me to speak on the generosity of a spiritual practice. And being the person that I am, I like to look at a big picture first. Then I like to take it apart. And in my head, I was trying to take it apart as a mathematical equation. Looking at my spiritual practice and looking at generosity, you can't break it apart. It's hand in hand. It's God. It's who God is, and who God wants us to be. It's a manifestation of Him. My thoughts about a generosity spiritual practice opens a lot of doors. And I'll give you a quick example. When I was living in Berkeley, we'd come across a lot of homeless people and other individuals. And the previous church I attended, I was involved in street meals, which served the homeless. But what I would do is I would put some change in my pocket, or I would put a couple of dollars in my pocket. But I would roll up have somebody write on a sticky note, "Jesus loves you and he walks with you." And I would put this in my pocket. And as I go out the door and come across someone asking for change or asking for money, I would hand it to them. And this one time, I handed a dollar bill with a sticky note rolled up in it to this gentleman. And he automatically said, "Can I pray for you?" And my question is, "Yes, you can, but may I ask you what you want to pray for?" He goes, "I want to pray for God to give you sight." I said, "No, no, 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 don't do that." He goes, "Why?" I go, "God has given me sight. He's given me sight through His love and His grace and His mercy. What I would like to do is stand here before you, and together let's praise Him for what He's given me the ability to do." So that's by carrying that money and having that open generosity, it opens the door to share my thoughts and my feelings and where I'm at within my walk. Thank you.
With compassion for our needs, the risen Christ meets us on the road and calls us by name. As the handbell ensemble shares its offering of music, and as the ushers serve among us, I invite you to put your gift in the plate or simply to touch the plate as a sign of your gift. Let us worship God with our offering.
Thank you.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God for all that love has done. Creator Christ and Spirit One. Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, you shower us with abundant gifts every day. We are astounded by the gifts of, by the gift of life itself, and the blessing of friendship, and the possibility of newness.
Bless these offerings for the sake of those in need, in the name of God, the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
God speaks to us in many ways, and today for our prayer practice, you're going to need your bulletin cover again. We are going to practice something called Visio Divina. It's a way of divine seeing. And studying a piece of art as a sacred text that speaks to you. So you can do this practice at home with any piece of art or sculpture. You can think of it like putting on God glasses to see how an image illuminates Christ for you. So to start, just close your eyes and breathe. And invite God to come close to you. And when you are ready, you can open your eyes just enough to gaze upon this piece of art and keep breathing. Notice what colors speak to you. Feel how the colors have both a bold and yet unsettled quality. Take a moment. Ask yourself, what's been uncertain in your life? What's been clear? It's possible to hold both at the same time. And when you're ready, thank God for being with you when things are unsettled and when things are clear. Now notice where this painting has light around dark edges. As much as we might like the formula to be suffering plus waiting long enough equals overcoming, even the risen Christ bears his wounds. What might healing mean for you today? What might it mean for someone you love? And when you're ready, thank God for all the ways that healing is possible. Easter is the story of a new beginning. Feel where there is movement in this piece of art. Imagine yourself in that movement, in the wisps and angles. Where in your life would you like a new start? Who do you love who needs a fresh start? And when you're ready, thank God for new beginnings. Let us pray. God, we thank you for being with us when things are unsettled and when things are clear. We thank you for all the ways that healing is possible. And we thank you for the person of Jesus, whose love shines new beginnings into our very lives and into our world. It is in the name of our sibling Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 228. In body or spirit, please stand and sing The Day of Resurrection.
The day of resurrection, earth tell it out abroad. The Passover of gladness, the Passover of God. From death to life eternal, from sin's dominion free. Our Christ has brought us over with hymns of victory. Our hearts be pure from evil, that we may see aright. The Lord in rays eternal of resurrection light. And listening to his accents, may hear so calm and plain the voice of Christ, and hearing may raise the victor's strain. Now let the heavens be joyful, let earth its song begin. The world resound in triumph, and all that is therein. Let all things seen and unseen their notes of gladness blend. For Christ the Lord has risen, our joy that has no end.
A brief poem by Lucille Clifton called Spring Song. The green of Jesus is breaking the ground, and the sweet smell of delicious Jesus is opening the house, and the dance of Jesus' music has hold of the air, and the world is turning in the body of Jesus, and the future is possible. And now may the grace of God Almighty, the love of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and forevermore. Amen.